moment she first opened her mouth on the Mike Walsh Show, Jeanne Little became a national treasure and one of our most unforgettable stars. Here's a quick look back at Jeanne's amazing life when her daughter Katie sat down with her old pal, Craigie Bennett.
Darling, are you paying attention?
Jeanne Little at her best, loud, vivacious and colourful.
You do like a sausage, don't you?
Oh, darling, I'd kill for one.
Absolutely.
Yeah, get a chilli on it too.
That's the person Australia fell in love with.
But diamonds are a girl's best friend.
Adding to her bling, a gold Logie she won in 1976.
Can I just thank Mike Walsh, who we all adore.
Our TV darling really was the Lady Gaga of her time when it came to fashion. Totally out there and fabulous.
I can't say I've ever seen trash look so good.
You're gorgeous, darling. I've always wanted a trashy image, darling.
She is one of a kind. And here to share some more incredible stories is Jeanne's daughter, Katie. Welcome to Studio 10.
Thank you so much for having me. Beautiful. Thank you.
Now, your book, Catch a Falling Star, is very candid. You hold nothing back.
Well, true, yes. What? I thought if I'm going to write this, I'm going to write, reveal everything. And there's things that came out in the book that even I didn't know about until I was writing the book. And suddenly I was like, oh my gosh, this is all shocking. But it all had to go in.
And was it
fascinating?
Was it hard to write? Was it hard to put those stories down on paper? And why did you?
Writing a book is like climbing Mount Everest. I think Mount Everest would actually be easier. It really, when Mum was sort of so sick, someone sort of said, write a book about growing up with your mum. And I thought, yes, that's what I'll do. And it was so sort of cathartic, I suppose, to be able to sit there and remember what Mum used to be like and all the fun, crazy memories. But, of course, everyone wanted to know what it was like, you know, when Mum got sick. And I thought, well, no one seems to be talking about this, the impact that Alzheimer's is having on whole families. And it goes on for sort of years and years and years, 10 years. Mm. So this is really putting it out there, basically.
How is Jeanne now?
She doesn't know anything, Kerri-Anne. Honestly, that's the only blessing that there is. But she is almost like a little child who sort of just sort of lies there and kind of looks up and blinks and stuff. And you think, really, is this the same person? Mm. It's heartbreaking.
No, it's not the same person.
It's not the same person. No, it's heartbreaking. Mm. Yes.
She'd hate it too, wouldn't she?
She would hate it, yes, more than anyone. Every time I think this is just crazy, Mum, you know, would not want to live like this at all.
She was such an iconic, one-of-a-kind person.
I'm,
I mean,
so
we saw this.
Yeah.
I feel like I can see her so much in you as well. It sounds like I'm talking to her.
It's in my genes.
But it is so true. She was the Lady Gaga.
Yes.
Lady Gaga must have been watching Jeanne Little all those times.
Yes.
She was Lady Gaga.
Phenomenal. But what was your mum really like behind the false eyelid? I mean, would
she
take
her
makeup off?
Well, she was a lightning bolt of energy. Like, she was like that all the time. There was always something to do, and she was so creative. She was just amazing, coming up with all these fabulous ideas. So I suppose you're kind of wondering what's going on with me, because I thought, you know, if I'm coming on Studio 10...
Should you stand up, Katie? If I'm coming on Studio 10,
I have to look fabulous. And so I was going to wear garbage bags, because Mum made all those wonderful dresses out of garbage bag dresses, and then I thought, well, nobody wears plastic anymore. So I'm the new generation.
So what's the celery in the bag?
Well, I'm a reusable shopping bag.
Of course you are.
So you see how good. Thank God the audience knows. So look, you know, you can just do your shopping and stick things down here. And, you know, it's not like the old days where when you stuck things in your handbag, people thought you were shoplifting. Don't you remember that?
Where's your Wheel of Edom, though? That's got to be there somewhere.
Oh, yes. Well,
it?
If I dig down, it's probably... Yeah,
there,
and don't put too much junk in your trunk or the bottom will fall out of your bag. You
should I take a baguette from you so you can sit down,
be
darling?
Would you like
Pass
some?
Me your baguette.
There you
oh, it's
go.
A bit bonky, isn't it? On a serious note.
We can go on a picnic later on.
On a serious note, though, Katie, as Sarah said, you've been very candid in this book.
Yes.
And you reveal something about your father's life before this wonderful woman, Jeanne, swept into his back in the 60s. And completely turned him around.
Well, this is true. I found it quite amazing, actually. I nearly brought on a roll of gaffer tape with me today to rip a bit off and stick it over Craig Bennett's mouth because it was Craig coming over, who's a fabulous sort of family friend, one night, and we were doing the dishes and washing up and stuff, and we'd both had a couple of drinks, and Craig sort of said, oh, you know, I don't blame you for sort of, you know, cutting that person out of your life, blah, 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 blah. And I just sort of went, oh, and he said, you did know, didn't you? And I said, yes, yes, I knew, sort of thing. And I thought, well, you know, that's amazing, really.
Well, you've got to fill us in now.
It took me quite a few days to sort of
process
it, and I had to ring a good friend of mine, Kate McDonald, who's Gary McDonald's daughter, and say, look, I've just found this out, and I'm sort of having trouble, you know, processing it. And the fact that I was having trouble processing it also made me question myself and the way I sort of see the world and think about it. And she said, look, you know, maybe it was just none of your business. Maybe that was your parents' life before you came along. And I went, yeah, you're right,
what,
you know?
What was the secret?
Well, I don't want to come straight out and say exactly what I discovered. There was a couple of big things, actually. There's two things that come out at the end, which I found very, very amazing and really enlightening about my parents' lives. And because of this, and because I've put it in the book, and I had to sit down with my father and say, Dad, I need to tell you what's in the book before it comes out. And so, you know, and so we've had some amazing conversations.
But what people will get from the book, they will, yes, if we know exactly what you're talking about, what they will get from the book is pages and pages of emotion, how you dealt with it, and how your journey. So you've got to tease them with what it is so they can then understand your life, the years and the pages will unfold for them when they read it.
Yeah, I think, look, my parents had their own lives before I came along, and what I've spoken to about Dad is, and he's lovely now and sort of says, I keep thinking of the night I met your mother and that's the night we fell in love. And she completely sort of captivated him and changed his life dramatically. So I didn't know before that, you know, like I just kind of thought, yeah, they're my parents and that's the way they all are all the time. But everyone's got their own.
But has your father adjusted to the fact that you know?
He has, you know, and and I feel actually really privileged that we've now turned this corner where he's telling me stuff that I never thought I'd have these conversations with my father.
Does he tell you why he didn't open up earlier?
Well, you know what? I just, like Kate McDonald said, I don't think it was any of my business.
Or he thought you knew.
Well, maybe not thought I knew, but Mum did used to say things every now and then. And
such as,
you know, I'd be an alcoholic and Barry'd be gay if we hadn't sort of got married and stuff. So she'd sort of drop in things like this all the time, and then Dad would be in the kitchen sort of saying, shush, Jean, shush, shush, shush. And, like, now I look back, I sort of go, well, of course, you know, because back then it was a different age. You don't realise how much life has changed in one generation.
Some of us do.
Mum used to wear garbage bags. We didn't think about using plastic and filling up the ocean with stuff. All we were concerned about with, oh, quick, you know, let's get rid of the deodorant cans because there's CFCs in it. That was it. That was the only environmental crisis there was. And same with these big secrets I found out about my parents. Like, you know.
But so your dad's cool with it, isn't he? Totally comfortable.
He is
now.
Cool, yeah. And I, you know what? Like, we've just come so far in one generation that my kids come home from school and say all sorts of things and my daughter will sort of say, Mum, you know what, I don't think I'll get married. And then she comes home and goes, you know what, I'm not going to have kids. Actually, I'm marrying my girlfriend and we're going to grow up and have a lesbian relationship. And I go, well, that's cool, and you might change your mind, you know, in a few years' time after that. But isn't it nice to be able to actually think, well, I could do this or I could do that without any kind of stigma or weirdness? Yes, freedom.
So
amazing.
So your incredible mum was such a force of nature, she managed to turn your father.
Well, yeah, she basically just beguiled him, like, the night they met, and he says he thinks over that night now, over and over, and sort of says that night is when they fell in love.
Wow.
They met at a party, they stayed up all night talking all night, and that was it, you know, they were magically in love. And now he started telling me other stuff too, and I go, Dad, it's too much information. Oh, no, 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 whoa, no, thank you. I don't know to know that, no, thank
and
you.
After knowing that, you know, your dad's love interests in sort of the opposite sex did come about, does that change the way you look at love now and the way you kind of look at sexuality? Because often you hear people say, I fall in love with a person. I'm not a sexuality, I fall in love with personality.
You know what, Dad was like, I'm 50-50 mum and 50-50 dad. And Dad, you know, was sort of inspired by Truman Capote and who wrote sort of Holly Go Lightly and that sort of, you know, that sort of story and stuff and wanted that kind of. And I look back now and I go, well, of course, that's just my dad. Mm. But you know, I can also say too that the person who you know, Dad had been with before Mum, like when you read the book, you sort of go, whoa, what? Like the same as I did when Craig sort of, you know, accidentally sort of spilled the beans while we were sort of doing the washing up kind of thing. So it did take me a while to process, and it just made me think again, more than anything, how remarkable my mum was.
Yep.
Because She was such a contradictory, like, there's so many contradictory things about her.
Very talented. She knew how to deliver.
Absolutely.
And trust me, listening to you, she's not gone.
I know, I know.
It's in my genes. Exactly.
Gone. No.
The one fabulous memory that you have of her, can you share from when you were a little girl?
Oh, look, there's so many fun sort of memories in the book. Mum was such a generous, caring, lovely person. There's all these fun memories. Like, I used to have a little friend, you know, when we were sort of small, who we took her to Pearl Beach sort of thing to go swimming. I said, like, it's when you go, you know, like doing jump rope in the playground and you just got to run in sort of thing, and once you get in there, you'll be fine. And she was like, I'm not sure. And I said, come on, in you go kind of thing. And so I sort of dragged her into the ocean with me, and she got dumped terribly, and my mum was sort of there saying, oh, 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 you know, Nicole, are you okay? Are you
just
okay?
Just like that too.
Just like that, and sort of patting her back and all this stuff. Are you all right? Sort of thing. Don't worry, I'll drive you home. And my father's going, are you kidding? It's a 2-hour round trip. You can't drive her home now. Like, this is crazy. And I was sort of sitting there the whole time going, look, just because it's the first time you've died, you know, I've nearly died several times. I used to fry sort of poppadoms in flannelette pyjamas. And the 80s was crazy. You know, when we had a pinata, we were using, you know, 4x8s or what is that called? I don't know how
Superfors,
to build.
Yeah.
Yeah, of wood, like, you know,
with a nail,
absolutely,
through one end.
Yeah, parenting back then was such a different story. So, you know, Mum just let me do whatever I wanted.
I love
great.
The title, Catch a Falling Star.
Thank you,
that
Kerri-Anne.
Is such a lovely
Thank
title.
You. Well, all the chapters are song title names. So, the first half of the book is all 80s song title names. So, it gets you into the swing of going, that's right, it was so different back then. Mm. It was a fun childhood.
Oh, Katie, it's been fabulous speaking with you, and you are your mum.
Oh,
you really are. And
thank you.
It's fabulous talking to you.
Writing a book, finally, I feel like I'm doing the thing that I was put on earth to do. So I'm so thrilled to be getting out, and thank you so much for having me on.
And thank you for dressing up.
Pleasure.
Wow.
Pleasure.
Up you get to the 12.